We're live? Right on. Thank you. Well, my name is William, and this is Diane. We're going to be the ones to open up the service tonight. And greetings all the way from Carberry, Manitoba.
Greetings.
Yes, see, we even have our greeters here. Thank the Lord. And but also, too, this is our 10th day and our 21st session. So welcome. If you're tuning live from Africa or wherever you're from, we say welcome. So we just thank the Lord just for today, just for what he has been doing in the lives of God's people, in the hearts of his people. And the Lord's been doing some new things, you know, and even in my own heart, God's been doing some new things. And I thank God the scripture tells us that all things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. You know, so I just wanted to encourage you this evening just to celebrate, praise, and worship with us as we continue with this journey that we're on. And I just thank the Lord just to be here. And again, we love you and greetings all the way from Carberry. Okay, Diane, you're up. Thank you.
Well, greetings, everybody. This evening, I just like to thank the Lord to be here. And we had an awesome day today. And we just give all the glory and praise unto the Lord. And want to thank everyone that came and shared and showed up today. Mm-hmm. And blessings to Leslie and Ray.
Mm-hmm.
For the house of God.
Amen. And
helping us and supporting us and guiding us today. And I just want to give God all the glory and the praise for this evening.
Amen. Okay. Well, thank you, Diane, for that greeting. And again, beloved, we appreciate you and we thank you for joining in into Resurrection Life Ministry, you know, in Carberry, Manitoba. So again, thank you just for being a part of the service with us. And I just want to just open up in this with this verse found in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1. Because we're, you know, I thank God that we're all made alive in Christ.
Yeah.
And I'm reading from the Amplified Version here. It says, "And you, he made alive when you were spiritually dead." We were dead at one time. "And he separated from him because of your transgressions and sins." Now look at this. "In which you once walked," so we didn't walk that way at one time. "You were following the ways of this world, influenced by this present age, in accordance with the prince of the power of the air, Satan, the spirit who is now at work in disobedience, the unbelieving, who fight against the purpose of God." So we can see the battle there. Our warfare is not with one another as brothers and sisters in Christ, but the enemy, he's at war with us. And I really thank God that it is God who was he not only fills you and I, but he empowers you and I with his word, with his spirit, with his presence. And we keep going on with his next verse. This is in verse 4. "But God, being so very rich," I thank God we serve a very rich God, "in mercy," thank God for his mercy, "because of his great and wonderful love which he has loved us." And look what Paul says. "Even when we were spiritually dead and separated from him because of our sins, he made us spiritually alive together with Christ." And I really thank God that God sent forth his son. John 1:16, we all very familiar with the verse that God sent his son to the world, right? So that we could live in him. You know, and but John 1:17 says this: "God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, you know, but to save the world, to love the world." So this is basically what our assignment in life. It's to love God's creation. Like what our brother shared today there in Brock. And, you know, I just thank God just for what we heard so far. You know, and look at this, verse 6. And this is a promise. This is actually the greater truth. Ephesians 1 tells us, it says, "Christ is seated in heavenly places, far above principalities, powers, might, rulers, spiritual wickedness in high places." But the greater truth is this, it's you and I. It says that when he raised us up together with him, when we believed, when we became believers, and he seated us with him in heavenly places. Because why? We are in Christ Jesus. It's not of ourselves, but it's because of him. It's who we are. This is where we're positioned. We're seated already with Him in heavenly places. So whatever battle that you're going through, whatever struggle that you're in, the Lord is still with you. Yes, He's with us. He will never leave us, nor will He ever forsake us. But the truth is that we're already seated with Him. So the secret is, when you go through things in life, you're going through life basically from that perspective of who you are in Jesus, right? We're not only just His son and His daughters, but we're children of the Most High. And so, again, it's about being positioned with Him. It's already being seated with Him. So once you take that place of who you are in Him, we have it made only in Christ and through Christ. Not of ourselves, not of each other, but only in Him. But we still need each other to build each other up, to encourage one another, and to lift each other up. So I just thank God that we know who we are in Christ. You know, we know who we are in Christ. I know who I am in Christ. Diane, everybody here knows who they are in Christ. So do you know who you are in Christ? Again, it's all about identity. You know, and I thank God that the scripture says we're no longer orphans, right? We're no longer orphans, but we're children of the Most High. You know, and I really thank God that God, according to John, that He gave us His Spirit. He gave us His Holy Spirit. He gave us His Comforter. He gave us His Helper to help you and I for everyday living. And one of the greatest promises that the Lord, I was thinking about today, I just felt like, even from this morning, I just wanted to just give a little word of encouragement here, that three greatest words that Jesus uttered to man, or for all of mankind, yes, it is "I love you," but I believe "it is finished." That's the words, "it is finished." When Jesus uttered the words, "it is finished," the scripture says that He gave up His ghost. But the beauty of that, though, is that the Spirit is no longer within the veil. And when you look in the Old and the New Testament, after when Jesus was crucified and when He was on the cross and that, the scripture says the veil was rented. It was parted from two places, like it was ripped in half. And when you look at the veil, according to what they say, is very heavy. Sometimes it took about a few hundred men to even lift up the veil because of the thickness and the width and the height of it. So in order for it to rip from top to bottom, that's just showing not only God's mercy, but His love for you and I. And that's why I thank God about the veil. The veil has been rented for you and I. So that way, we could boldly come before Him, before the throne of grace. You know, and I thank God that Jesus made that way for you and I through the help of His Holy Spirit. So I just thank the Lord just for that, that we do have the Holy Spirit and that He has made us alive in Christ. We are alive in Christ. We're not dead. And you know, one of the things, Diane and I, and we really appreciate what the Lord is doing. We thank God for the ordination, like we celebrate with not just with one another, but even for the other brothers and sisters today. We had a powerful ordination service where actually we could see the mist and the glory of the Lord in our midst today. And so I thank God is that we're able to do that together. You know, to celebrate and to be ordained. And it's not so much about the title, but it's because it's the calling that God has on our life. We're all called. The Bible says we're all called. And for me to be called, like, I remember one time when I gave my heart to the Lord and the Lord spoke to me what my calling was. That was like 27 years ago. And here I thought God was going to send a baby in the ministry field. That's not how it works. Right? You can't send babies in the ministry field because why? Their pampers will fall off. Right? Right? And so when we think of babies, and that's why, like, when Brock was sharing some of the words about maturity today, I really thank God for God's people are being mature. You look at the life of Jesus Christ, only three times or only twice prior to his calling to walk out His high priestly role, as you know, only time we ever see Jesus is when He was born in a manger, being a baby, right? When He was 12 years old during the bar mitzvah stage, doing about His Father's business in the temple. And the third time that is when He came out is when He was sent by God, after He was baptized by the Holy Spirit. The scripture says He was led by the Spirit of God into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Wow. You see? So in order for us to go through things in life, we not only have to be baptized, but I really believe we have to be led by His Spirit. And when we're led by His Spirit, there's no stopping of what God can do in your life. He will see you through all what you've been called to do. And so when my cousin told me, he says, brother, I don't want to deflate the bubble that's in your life. I know you're on this high of Jesus right now because you're a new creation in Christ. But the calling is just the beginning. You know, and it is. When God calls you, when you hear for the first time what you're called into, there's actually a process to get to that place of commissioning. You know, and that's why when you read what Matthew chapter 28, it speaks about the Great Commission, right? So when we look at the Great Commission, God is the one that calls us. He's the one that commissioned us, but He will always prepare us. There's always that stage of preparation. Then when we come into alignment with the mission and assignment that He has for us, then He will release us like today. Then He will send us out. So again, I appreciate you guys, and I thank God that God had commissioned us. Yeah. From this house, you know, I thank God that we're part of a local body. And that God had commissioned us from this house because, again, it's only the Lord that could do that kind of work, you know, in our life. And I just praise Him and I just thank Him just for His goodness and His kindness. So, again, greetings and blessings. And Diane, I don't know if you have anything else to share. Yeah? But yeah, you know. I'm picking up something in the spirit too, you guys. You know?
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. But, you know, yeah, we just thank God, you know, just to bring us here, to be a part of this family. And again, you know, we love Ray and Leslie. To meet our brother, you know, Brother Christopher, like, we love the brother. And our sisters, you know, we love each and every person here. Even out there, we love you all in Christ. Because, you know, it's Christ's love that's going to bring us together. Yeah. Christ is coming back. And what I shared yesterday or the other day, because we just feel like the Spirit is highlighting something here. Not just about husbands and wives, but He's highlighting His bride. He's speaking about His bride. And I shared something the other day about when you look at Adam and Eve. And I like what Bruce did today, and I like what Brock did today, you know, with their wives and that. See, and they what they did was they made room for their wives to walk alongside with them, right? Not under their feet or walk behind them, but to walk alongside of them. Yeah. Now, when Jesus was on the cross, what came gushing out of Him, right? Water and blood, right? And so because of that, you know, because of the water and blood, not only speaks of salvation, but Jesus was giving birth to something. Right? He was giving birth to His bride that was coming. That was in the making. So by the blood and water coming out of His side, He was saying, this is my church, you know, and who I'm well pleased. So this church is going to not walk under my feet, but He's going to walk alongside my bride. I'm going to walk alongside His bride to encourage her, lift her up. And that's why Paul mentions in Galatians chapter 5, he speaks about, Ephesians 5, where he says, husbands, love your wives as Christ have loved the church, and He gave Himself for it. And wives, respect your husbands as you would unto the Lord. But what I love about that, because Scripture also says that He's coming back for a church, right? Men, if you want your wife to keep coming back, keep coming into that place of intimacy, keep coming back into that place of being who she was created to be, the Scripture admonishes us to build her up. Right. Encourage her. So there's going to be times that your wife's going to feel like she has a blemish. Or she's going to feel that she has a spot. You know what I mean? Or maybe even the wrinkles. Like, oftentimes women have this kind of feelings of how they feel. And rather than men coming along and passing judgment and criticizing how she feels, encourage her. Uplift her. Build her up as Jesus built up His bride. So I just want to just leave that with you this evening. That He is coming back for us. And He's coming back for a bride who was ready. So right now, I believe we're on the verge of being ready. You know, and I just thank God for the readiness of just what He's doing at this time. So I think at this time, Stacy, we're going to call up Sister Stacy before we get into the word. But, you know, I just want to just thank the Lord for this woman of God all the way from Philadelphia of brotherly love.
Yeah.
You know, and then we just appreciate her for the calling and the assignment that is on her life as well. Blessings, my sister.
Amen.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Can we praise the Lord?
Yes.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Well done. Well done.
Thank you, Elder William and Elder Diane. Thank you for your service. William,
yes.
You've been doing this a long time. Well, praise the Lord, everyone. I have the honor and the privilege of introducing a wonderful guest speaker from Malawi, Africa. And before I introduce him, I want to give you three things that he highlighted with us the last time he ministered the word of God. He asked the question, and he said, how can I bring the order of heaven down on earth? Do y'all remember the answer? He said, be filled with the Holy Spirit. He said, we need to understand the seriousness of God and understand that it's his plan, not ours. And then he said that we must do it God's way.
Amen.
So the topic tonight is let the order of heaven come down. And I would ask you all to go with me to Ecclesiastes, the 12th chapter. And this is my introduction of Bishop Christopher Mwamlima.
Mwamlima.
Christopher Mwamlima. Mwamlima.
Yeah, it's kind of like a song.
So, Ecclesiastes, the 12th chapter, and beginning at verse 9. And moreover, because the preacher was wise, he still taught the people knowledge. Mm-hmm. Yea, he gave good heed and sought out and set in order many proverbs. The preacher sought to find acceptable words, and that which was written was upright, even words of truth. The words of the wise are as golds and as nails fastened by the masters of assemblies, which are given from one shepherd. And further by these, my son, be admonished of making many books, there is no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. Mm. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. So this is my introduction of this man of God tonight. And I pray that you will be blessed by the message that he's going to bring to us. And the closing scripture was talking about fearing God. And his message was truly about fearing God. And we need to put God back where he belongs, because it's not our church, it's his church.
Yes.
And we need to reverence him. So at this time, I would like to present to some and introduce to others, Pastor Christopher Mwamlima.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. God bless you.
Hallelujah. Thank you so much. Welcome once more to this evening session. Thank you so much, Sister Stancer from United States. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Brother. Oh, Brother William.
Yes.
Yes, God bless you so much for the wonderful exhortation that we had. Yeah, it's good to be back in the house of the Lord at this moment. I would like to welcome the viewers all over the world. Those that are following us since the conference started, and I would like to recognize some of my friends from Malawi and some from South Africa. From Malawi, we have Evangelist Charity Swira, we have Blessings Kwese, and in South Africa, we have Tia. And I welcome again. Thank you so much, Daddy Lai Johnson, for this wonderful moment that you have given me to share the word of God. And Mama Lee, I'm so much humbled to stand before you, mm-hmm. anointed servants of God. And my sisters over there, God bless you so much.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise God. I would like to continue with the message that I shared last time, that let the order of God come down. Let the order of God in heaven come down. What I've just observed, God is trying to build, not necessarily trying, but God is building something. Because all the speakers that we have heard, they are pointing at one particular thing. We had a wonderful exhortation during the ordination, and I thank God for the people that have been ordained. You know, an ordination is an indication that God is completely separating you, completely calling you into His service. Ordination. An ordination is something that taking you into an extra mile to be very careful about what God wants to do in your life. You know, when you have been given a responsibility, either in a society or somewhere, that shows you need to take some discipline measures as to what you have been doing what you have been doing in your life. You need to take an extra mile to be so careful, because now it's like, as Paul says in the epistles, that we are now the letters written by God Himself and read by so many people. It is people who are now be reading us, as we are the servants of God. We are the people now manifesting the presence of God. We are the people now, if people want to know God, they look at us as His servants, reflecting His own image. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 3, it says, Jesus is the exact representation of God Himself. So as Jesus is the exact representation of God, we are the representation of Jesus Himself. When people want to know Jesus, they look at us and they see Jesus in us. Hallelujah. Yeah. Now, so today I just want to take you to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 2, from verse 1 up to verse 5. Verse 1 up to verse 5. Corinthians chapter 2, from verse 1,
Amen.
Verse 5.
Amen.
Apostle Paul says, I'm reading from, this is a new Bible now, I'm reading from NLT. This is a New Living Translation. New Living Translation. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, from verse 1 to verse 5. When I first came to you, dear brothers and sisters, I didn't use lofty words and the impressive wisdom to tell you God's secret plan. For I decided that while I was with you, I would forget everything except Jesus Christ, the one who was crucified. I come to you in weakness, timid and trembling, and my message and my preaching were very plain, rather than using clever and persuasive speeches. I relied only on the power of the Holy Spirit. I did this so you would trust not in human wisdom, but in the power of God.
Amen.
You know, let me take you back first to the ordination that we had. And to the points that I raised last time, three points as our pastor was just going through of what I shared last time. Three points. He said, the number one thing, when God has called us, we need to understand the plan of God. According to Exodus 25, we read Exodus 25 from verse 8 and 9. We said we need to understand the plan of God. And we read more, the emphasis was on verse 40, where God said to Moses, see to it, Moses, that you build this ark according to the plan that you were shown on the mountain. So the responsibility number one is to understand the plan of God. And one has to understand to say, the plan is not for him. The plan is for the people that God has called him to lead. So the ordination, the anointing, the calling is not about me, but it is about the people that God wants me to lead. That's the number one thing. So when you understand, you need to understand the plan of God. Know seriously that this is not about me. This is about God. This is about the people. That's why God, when he was speaking, Jesus, when he was speaking to Peter, he said, Peter, do you love me? He said, yes, I love you. He said, feed my people. So it was not about Peter, but it was about the people that Jesus called Peter to lead. So that is the understanding that we need to have, that the plan is for God and the eyes of God are not upon me, but are upon the people that he has appointed me to lead. That's the number one thing. Then the number two, as I share to say, the seriousness of God. Now, when I talk about the seriousness of God, come to understand this. The Bible says in John, John chapter 3, the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. You know, God is very serious with his vision. This is the reason he gave Jesus Christ. He sacrificed, demonstrating the seriousness that he has, the salvation of the people. Are we together? The salvation of the people. So God is much serious. So if the owner is serious, I must be more serious as well.
Yes. Amen.
I must be more serious. If God is serious with the people, when Jesus was speaking to Peter, he says, feed my people. Peter, I've called you nothing else. I need you to lead these people. So you need to feed them. He says, the reason I came down, the reason I came here on earth is to die for these people, to save them. So death is a symbol of seriousness. So when God is serious, we also need to be serious. Then I said, the other thing, the reason God showed Moses the pattern was that Moses is not supposed to copy from other people, because the design and whatever God needs, he does not copy from, he does not take from what is on in the world, but he sees what he has created in heaven, and he wants that what is in heaven to come here on earth. So it was very easy for God to show Moses whatever was here. Say, I need you, Moses, to build and act like that house. But God never appointed to any of the work that somebody made under the sun. But he showed Moses what he had in heaven according to what he wants to accomplish. So when God is an ordaining us, appointing us, calling us, he is making us an instrument to touch his people. An instrument to touch his people. We are simply there as a vessel that God wants to use to touch his people. So there's no glory in us, but there's only the glory belongs to God himself. I'm simply a vessel through which God blesses the people. I'm simply a vessel through which God heals the people. I'm simply a vessel. I'm nothing else. So this is the reason now when we come to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, say, Paul says, when I came to you, I did not come with the wisdom of this world. I did not come with the eloquence of this world. I did not come with the appearance of this world. I did not come as other people do come. But when you are properly observed me, I came in fear and trembling. In other words, he's saying, I came and I minused myself and I wanted Jesus Christ to increase and not me. Amen. That Jesus must increase and not me. And secondly, he says, there's only one thing that when you observed me properly, there was a demonstration of power so that your faith should not be in me, should not be in anything else, but should be in the power of God. So that is bringing us to the point, the question that I said, how do we bring the order of God from heaven here on earth? And we said, by being filled with the Spirit of God. You know, so Paul says, when I came to you, the only thing that I wanted to manifest amongst you is the power of God, so that your faith should not be built on me as Paul, but should be built on the power of God. He says, it should be built not on me, that sometimes you should be waiting. Where is Paul? What is happening? No. You know, there's one thing that we need to understand in the plan of God. The one whom the plan has been handed to shall pass away, but plan remains. The plan of God remains. So that's why it is not about you. It is about the plan of God. Amen. When God calls me, I will go, but the plan of God will remain. Moses was called to lead the people into the promised of land, but he did not step in the promise of the, on that promised land. Hallelujah. He never stepped in that promise. But the purpose or the reason when God took them from Egypt, he made sure that they enter the promised land, but Moses did not. So it is not about Moses, it is about the vision, it is about the plan. Yes, it's not about the vision, it's not about Moses, it is about the plan, because that plan came out of the mouth of God. So the Bible says, whatever comes, God watches his own ways, perform what it says. So because God uttered the words, even if the people made a mistake in the wilderness, God said, these people, surely they are not going to enter into this promise. Then Moses had to pray to God to say, God, people will say, you have failed. And then God said, okay, I've reversed my decision. But when you study the Bible, you discover that the people who came from Egypt are not the people who entered the promised land. It is another generation. It is another generation. So God is serious with his words. The moment he utters a word, he watches the word. He watches the word. So Paul says here in 1 Corinthians, he says, I came in that humble way. I came in that manner. I minused myself. I made it sure that it is about Jesus, not me. I made sure that he let his power manifest. So as we are the servants of God, may we bring back the power of God in the church. Because that is the order of heaven. May we bring back the power of, you know, it's the church. When we say, when God was saying, build me this ark, he says, what he said to Moses, he says, I would want to reside in that ark. So we are the building, the temple of God. So we must manifest the power of God, because that is the order. We do not manifest before the people, but let God manifest before the people. We do not bring ourselves before the people, but we bring God before the people. That is the order. Amen. So this is the reason Paul says, when you need God to appear before the people, you must be filled by the Spirit of God. Amen. You know, the Spirit of God changes somebody. Amen. The Spirit of God changes somebody. You know, when you study Paul, and he says, Paul grew up in a city, and Jesus grew up in a village. And now, when God was calling, when God was processing, as Daddy Ray said it the first day, he says, you know, God is the processor and he processes us. So God was processing Paul in the city when Jesus was being processed in the village. Because God knew that when the time comes for Paul to turn to God, he will not have fear of these people in the city. So let me process him in this city. He should be familiar with these people in the city. And then when the Spirit of God came upon Paul, he never feared anybody in the city. The Bible says he argued with them about the word of God. Because he grew in that city. God processed him in that city. But he said, when he came to God, he says, oh, now God has appeared unto me. Let me decrease and show Jesus to these people. Glory be to God. Amen. The order of the church, we have the responsibility, brethren. We have the responsibility. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's about God himself. Look onto this. It's about God himself. It's not about me. I'm simply a vessel. You are simply a vessel. That's why Paul says, I do not glory in myself, but I glory in the power of God. So he says, when you're speaking to the Ephesians, he says, be filled with the Spirit of God. Because what distinguishes you from any other people, from any group of the people, it is the presence of God, the Spirit of God in you. The Spirit of God in you is what brings the difference in your life. Right. That's the Spirit of God brings the uniqueness. I don't know how I can put it. Separates you from any other person. There's nothing that brings a difference between you from these other ordinary people apart from the Spirit of God. It's only the Holy Spirit. So this is the reason Paul says, be filled. And he went on to say, to argue in the book of the Romans, he says, when you live by the Spirit of God, when the Spirit of God indeed is in you, you are the children of God. You are a child of God. When indeed, and he says, when the Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead lives in you, you are the children of God. Hallelujah. So what we need to have when we want to bring, when we say, I am the vessel of God, what is it that you present before the people? Do you present yourself or you present the power of God? That is the order of God. You know, the reason, even when Jesus was, I said in the first place, let me explain go a little bit deeper on this one. When Jesus was descending into heaven, he says, I'm not going to leave you alone, but I will send the Spirit of God. You know, when I was studying the Bible, I've discovered the three kind of prayers that is recorded in the Bible that Jesus prayed. There's the number one, according to me, the prayer that Jesus prayed in Gethsemane. The Bible records the words that he uttered. And the Bible says even the sweat tend to be what? To be bread. And then this other prayer that he prayed when he was on the cross, he says, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. Yes. Mm-hmm. The Bible has recorded that prayer. And the third prayer is the prayer that he prayed when he was about to go to heaven. He says, Father, I thank you for these people that you have given me. Mm-hmm. I pray that they may be one, mm-hmm. as you and me are one. Yeah. But now when the Bible always says, the life of Jesus was the life of prayer. Then I wanted to understand what kind of prayer was Jesus praying. Let's go to Hebrews chapter. Is it 5 verse 7? Hebrews chapter 5 verse 7. If I'm correct, right? If it is not, chapter 7 verse 5. Sorry for that one. Hallelujah. Yeah, it's chapter 5, verse 7. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 7. The Bible says, while Jesus was here on earth, he offered prayers and pleading with a loud voice and tears to a one who could rescue him from death. And God held his prayers because his deep reverence for God. He says, Jesus, while he was here on earth, the kind of the prayers that he prayed, his lifestyle was the life of prayer, and the prayer was of that loud voice and tears. So being filled with the Spirit of God does not come on a silver platter. It requires prayer. If you are not prayerful, forget about being filled with the Spirit of God if you are not prayerful. For the Bible says when Jesus was baptized on the day of his baptism, the Spirit of God descended on him and led him into prayer. So the number one thing, if you have the Spirit of God, the number one thing that comes in your life is the hunger for prayer. Because the prayer will multiply. If the prayer will bring the amount of the Spirit of God that is required in your ministry. So there's nothing that must take place of prayer in your life.
So this is the kind of prayer when a lady says, Jesus himself, and the Bible says he was God. But look into what kind of prayers he was praying. He was praying with loud voice. He was praying with tears, crying to God. Why was he crying to God? Because he was found in the flesh. When you read Hebrews chapter 2, the Bible says, because we, the children of God, we are of the flesh and blood. So he partook that nature. So because of that, he found himself in the nature of being a weak figure. So this is the reason he was crying each day before God. This is the reason he was crying with that loud voice, Father, let your power come on me. I cannot minister without your power. The sick can never be healed without the power. I cannot have that hunger for your will without the power. Because what ages me, what pushes me is your power. That's why in Zechariah chapter 4, the Bible says, it is not by power, nor by might. It is not by might, nor by power, but by the Spirit of God. Amen. By the Spirit of God. So the order of God is in the Spirit of God. When when Jesus was speaking in Matthew, he says, the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of lusciousness. Amen. Lusciousness? Yes. What else? Hallelujah. It says it's not a matter of eating and drinking, but of lusciousness. Lusciousness. That's the number one thing now, how to bring the order of God, I said, by being filled by the Spirit of God. And how can one be filled by the Spirit of God? It is by prayer. It is by prayer. It is by prayer. How many times do you pray in your life? Prayer is the engine of your ministry. Prayer is what pushes you to go deeper in the ministry. Prayer is what gives you power. Prayer is what brings faith in you. Prayer is what builds you in the ministry. Yes. You cannot work, you cannot be filled by the Spirit of God minus the power, minus the prayer life. You know, I just want to share with you a testimony. When I was coming here and the enemy rose like a flood, I said, I have the Spirit of God. And one thing I've determined, I'm going to Canada and I'll be part of the conference that is taking place there. I prayed like never before. Those who were watching me on my page, they could see my prayers. I said, let them see my prayer the way I'm crying before God. Because I know the breakthrough, for me to break and find myself in that particular place, it will take my prayer. So there's nothing that should take position in your life apart from prayer. Prayer is the integral part of your spiritual life. It's the integral part of your spiritual life. I don't know how can I speak more about this prayer. Prayer must be as natural as you are breathing. The way you breathe, the prayer must be as natural as you are breathing. Sometimes when you are walking, you are speaking in tongues. Rabba Jaco, Rima Mama Zakaraba, Riba. You are alone, you are walking around your house, your room, you are praying. Riba Zako, Rabba Baba. You are preparing yourself to go out and minister. You are preparing yourself to go out and preach, but you speak in tongues in your prayer, because what you need to manifest there is not yourself. You need to bring the order of God. People must see God so that their faith must be built on God and not on you. Right. Yes. That is the order of God. You know, this is the time. If we have got a time that this generation needs God, this is the time. And there are not any other people that can bring the order of God apart from you and me. We are the right people. You know, when we were listening to the prophecy of this land, said this is the land where revival shall take place. And who is going to bring that revival? It is you and me. If we only begin to kneel down and cry with loud voice and tears, oh Father, we see people are perishing without knowing Jesus. But when we kneel down and we say, Father, let me go out, use me, here I am, oh Lord. God is still asking a question. Whom can I send? That question is still there. Amen. Whom can I send? That's the number one thing. Bringing order is by being filled with the spirit of power, with the spirit of God through prayer. Then the number two thing, you know, there's this thing that kills so many ministries. there are so many people that God calls, but there are very few people that lead a step into the ministry that God has called them. There are very few people that manifest the power of God. The number two thing is the humbleness. I'd like if somebody can say humble.
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 This is the generation that is too proud. The generation that is very proud. Generation that is very proud. God does not use a proud person. Never. Philip chapter 2. Sorry, I'll be speaking scriptures. Philip chapter 2. Philippians. Philippians. I speak like I'm in Malawi. Philippians chapter 2. The Bible says, have this mind that was with Jesus Christ. Have this mind that was with Jesus Christ. And what is that mind? When you read that scripture, you find that the mind that Jesus had was the mind of humbleness. The Bible says he never equated himself to God, though he was God. He became like a man. And he even went lower than man. He became a servant. He became a servant. You know where the word servant comes from? You know, well, I'm coming from the place where we use, you guys here in Canada, you use, when you have got boats with engines. In Malawi, we have got legs, but most of the boats that we have there is manual boats. Mm. So Paul says, servant are those people that they pedal the boat. People come into the boat, but there's somebody who makes sure that this boat must go to that other side of the lake. And that person is a servant. So Paul says, I'm the servant. Mm-hmm. Peddling people to the other side. I'm the servant. Peddling people. There are so many people in the boat. My duty is to take them to that other side. So the Bible says Jesus humbled himself. He lowered himself and he came to a point of you becoming like you and me. But that was not even enough. He went further. He became the servant, making sure that he presents you and me before God without any spot. So the number two thing for you to bring the order, for me to bring the order of God in the church, I must be the most humble person. I must become the servant, not that people serve me, but I must be the servant. God has called me to serve, and whom am I serving? I'm serving his people. That's why it is not about me. It is about his people. So I'm serving his people. I must be the servant of the people. Sometimes when I go to church, I find that the church is, everything is not in order. I begin to do, making sure that when the people come, they must sit at a comfortable place. I serve them. My responsibility is to serve them, to bring them before God without any spot. Am I talking to somebody?
Amen.
Praise be to God. So the number two thing, humbleness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Wow.
Humbleness. You cannot minus humbleness in the kingdom of God. That's the reason the enemy, the devil, came from heaven and he is here on earth, because he failed to humble himself.
Mm-hmm.
So humbleness you cannot minus in the kingdom of God. That's the number two point. Humble yourself. See to it that you are. I don't know where I'm coming from. This is becoming a problem. Where I'm coming from. Maybe my sisters from Africa can agree with me. Where I'm coming from. Where we are coming from. Humbleness to the servants of God. The servants of God themselves. Humbleness is becoming a problem. They want to be saved and not to serve.
Yeah.
So whoever is watching me, if you have reached a point of that people saves you, know for sure that the power of God has departed from you like King Saul himself. The power of God departed from him for 17 years, but still more, he had that title of a king. But the power of God had already departed him. So we are so many people in the house of God. The power of God has departed from us because we lack the spirit of humbleness. No element of humbleness. The Bible says because of the humbleness of Jesus, God elevated him to a place where now he is the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings. It is the spirit of humbleness that promotes you in the kingdom of God. It is the spirit of humbleness that brings the order, the power, the anointing of God upon your life. Humbleness. When you are a man or a servant of prayer and you have the spirit of humbleness, you become a container of the power of God.
Amen. Wow.
You become the container of the power of God. God fills you with your wisdom. Sometimes you cannot manifest the power of God, but every word that you utter from your mouth is full of wisdom and knowledge. So that's the number two fact. You know, let me say this thing. When Paul was speaking to Timothy, he said, Timothy, my son, listen very well. Because that was the time Paul was about to die. So he was tying everything to Timothy. I pray to God that God gives us the spirit of listening and understanding. For God is taking us into the field. He's not taking animals. He's taking us. Now, these are the requirements that we need to have. A man of prayer, a servant of prayer, that he prays a day and night, that he knows that my power comes from God. It's not about me. It is about God. He cries before God. He kneels before God. Tears coming, mucus coming. Father, thank you. You know, it is a privilege to be a servant of God. Very wonderful.
Amen.
To be a servant of God.
Amen.
It's a privilege.
Amen.
You know, Jeremiah said, when I want to stop, but I cannot stop because your word in me is like fire. So sometimes we get tired and we would want to sit down, but if we have got the word of God always, we will not last. Sometimes we last because there is no word in us. So minus the word, there is no fire in us. Praise be to God. Let me continue. Let me continue. Let me go again to the third point that brings. Let's open John chapter 1. I'll be speaking. The Bible says, in the beginning, there was a word, and the word was with God, and the word was God himself. And the word became flesh, and we saw the glory of God. And in Corinthians, the Bible says, it pleased God to put his fullness in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Who is the Word? Let me say it again. John chapter 1. The Bible says, in the beginning there was a Word, and the Word was with God.
Yeah.
And the Word was God.
Amen.
And the Word became flesh. That's the word. And we saw the glory of God in our midst.
Amen.
And in Corinthians, it says, it pleased God to put his fullness in Christ Jesus. So you cannot separate the word of God from God himself. You cannot. I'm kind of like teaching. You cannot separate. You cannot separate God from his word. He is the word. He is the word. So you cannot be a servant of God without God himself, without his own word. What are you going to teach? What are you going to say? If you do not have a word, you are an empty vessel. So your responsibility to bring God, you must be a library of the word of God. You must be a library of the word of God.
Amen.
Maybe this vocabulary is not correct. You must be the container of the word of God.
Amen.
You know, when God was sending Jeremiah, he simply said, Jeremiah, I've put my word on your tongue, nothing else. He never changed the face of Jeremiah. He never changed the status of Jeremiah. He never changed the appearance of Jeremiah. But he said, he gave them the invisible thing that when Jeremiah tried to touch his tongue, he couldn't even feel the word of God on his tongue. But God said, I've put my word on your tongue. So the weapon that God gives us in his field is the word. So my prayer and my word today is that may you be the library of the word of God. May you be the container of the word of God. You cannot function in the body of Christ. You cannot function outside there beyond the knowledge you have of the kingdom of God. You cannot go beyond, even in the secular world, you cannot be employed beyond your knowledge. Your knowledge limits you what you are supposed to do in the secular world. So it is the same in the body of Christ. You cannot function beyond the knowledge of the kingdom of God that you have. So this is the reason when God was instructing to Joshua, he said, see to it that this book do not depart from you. Amen. See to it that it does. He says, meditate, read, chew it. I mean, bring it in your mind. Let it be you. Let be in this word. Let this word be in you and you in word. So he says, you shall be successful. So the word of God brings success in the ministry, in the field that God has given you. Amen. Am I talking to somebody else? The word of God will give you no limit. You will be limitless when you have got the word of God in you.
Thank you.
You'll be limitless. Nobody will stand before you. David says the entrance of the way. He says, I'm more wiser than my enemies because of your word in me.
Amen.
I'm more wiser than my enemy. So the only way that we become more wiser than whatever the enemy brings in our life, whatever the difficulties we face in the ministry, is the word of God. That's our wisdom. That's our wisdom. So the word of God, that's the number three. Because what do you bring? The order of God. You do not preach about yourself. You preach about Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You do not preach what you have. You preach Jesus himself. You present Jesus to people. So when bringing the order of God from heaven here on earth is by speaking the word of God, by preaching the word of God, by uttering the word of God, because the word of God is God himself. Mm-hmm. Let him be the center of your ministry.
Amen.
Let him be the center of your sermon.
Yeah. Amen.
God himself.
Amen.
Today, God is no longer exalted in the church. Today, it is me who is exalted in the church. Today it's not about Jesus preached in the church. I don't know if you have ever, if it is with you here in Malawi, either in America, you say, you know, when he says you have got this problem, the only thing that you have this problem is because you never met me. Do I have to meet you or to meet Jesus?
Yeah, that's right. Exactly.
I have to meet Jesus, not you. So this is the order. People now, they have substituted God in the church and they are sitting on the chair of God in the church. So we as a resurrection, then when I sat there, I started meditating, chewing the word resurrection life. Oh, I said, okay, resurrection life in a very simple term, meaning living in the new life of Christ. Because when Jesus resurrected, when the Bible says when we accept Jesus Christ, we die and we rise together with him. So we live a resurrection life.
Amen.
May we bring the word of God in the church. That's what we preach.
Yes.
Praise be to God.
Yeah.
This is that what I had this evening that I should share with the body of Christ.
Amen.
I'm so thankful for your attention. May God bless you so much. And everybody who's watching us, God bless you so much. Mm. Understand we have gotten one, two, three things that God has spoken to us this evening. May I welcome the woman of God to wind up everything. Praise be to God. Amen. Praise be to God. I'm so humble. I'm so humble, servant of God. Hallelujah.
God bless you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for the word. Praise the Lord. What a word. What a word. It's not about us. And it's all about God. And what is standing out to me is we must decrease so that he may increase. We thank you so much for the word and for teaching us the precepts of his word and how for our ordination today. And that was just very timely, very timely. Thank you so much. We pray that everyone has been blessed by tonight's message. And those of you that have been watching us at home, it's not about you. It's not about the people that you go to. Earlier this week, I said many people are running after the prophecy. But God is the prophecy. His word is prophecy. So stop seeking people and start seeking God. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the answer. When we turn to man, we're turning away from God. So make a U-turn tonight and give your heart to God. We love you and we thank you for being with us the last 10 days, 8, 9 days, 10. And we welcome you to join us tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. for our morning worship service. So God bless you and have a wonderful night.
Amen.